Blink TV presents Mosaic World News from the Middle East. Here are today's top stories.
Iran denies role in bomb attacks on Israeli embassies. Pakistani tribesmen protest U.S. drone strikes. And Iraqi women's rights activists outraged at government-imposed dress code. Mosaic, world news from the Middle East, begins now.
Israeli officials said at least two people were wounded in the blast near the Israeli embassy in New Delhi. Meanwhile, Israel said Georgian police dismantled the bomb targeting Israeli embassy employees in the Georgian capital,
Tbilisi.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu accused Iran of being behind the attacks on Tel Aviv's two embassies in India and Georgia. Tehran denied the accusation, considering it to be part of Israel's propaganda war.
Israeli diplomats have been the target of recurring attacks in a number of countries. This time, the assailants targeted the Israeli embassies in India and Georgia. Israeli officials said a bomb exploded in New Delhi, while another was dismantled in Tbilisi. The two attacks did not lead to any fatalities. However, Indian Interior Ministry said two drivers and the wife of a diplomat were wounded in the bombing near the Israeli embassy in New Delhi. According to a spokesman for the Israeli embassy, the New Delhi blast occurred this afternoon, the result of a bomb planted in a diplomat's car. The Israeli Prime Minister, who described the incident as terrorism, was quick to accuse Tel Aviv's enemies in Iran and Hezbollah in Lebanon.
Iran, which is behind the two operations, is the top initiator of terror in the world. The Israeli government and security institutions will continue to work with the security institutions of the two countries against the terrorist operations.
Coinciding with the Delhi incident, a spokesman for the Georgian Interior Ministry said a bomb was planted inside the car of a driver who works for the Israeli embassy in the Georgian capital, Tbilisi, and that the police managed to dismantle the bomb. So far, no party has claimed responsibility for the two incidents. However, Netanyahu said Israel had recently foiled similar attacks in Azerbaijan and Thailand. Iran denied responsibility for the attacks on the two Israeli embassies in Georgia and India, considering Israel's accusations to be part of its propaganda war against Iran. This leaves the door open for further speculations.
اهلا ومرحبا بكم. قالت مفوضة الامم المتحدة لحقوق الانسان نافي بيلاي.
UN High Commissioner for Human Rights نافي بيلاي presented a report on human rights in Syria to the UN General Assembly. بيلاي said it is currently impossible to get a count of the dead and injured in Syria since the international organization is unable to enter the Syrian territory. بيلاي said credible reports indicate that over 5,000 people have been killed since last year.
While no exact figures can be provided due to our lack of access to the country,
credible reports indicate that Syrian security forces killed well above 1,500 people last year, including civilians as well as military personnel who refused to shoot civilians. Due to extreme difficulties in substantiating the events on the ground, it has become almost impossible for my office to update the death toll in the past 2 months. However, we are certain that the number of dead and injured continues to rise every day. Tens of thousands, including children, have been arrested, with more than 18,000 reportedly still arbitrarily held in detention. Thousands more are reported missing. 25,000 people are estimated to have sought refuge in neighboring and other countries, and more than 70,000 are estimated to have been internally displaced.
As for Bashar al-Jafari, Syria's ambassador to the UN, he objected to Pillai's report, saying it clearly charges his country on the basis of reports, not on the ground results.
It clearly accuses my country and my country's government of violating human rights, basing the allegations on reports, as Madam Commissioner said. She mentioned the word reports dozens of times in her statement.
Reports. وليس استنادا إلى نتائج على الأرض.
Reports, not on-the-ground results, visits and discussions with the Syrian government or cooperation with the National Committee established by the Syrian government to investigate human rights violations.
في انتهاكات حقوق الإنسان.
On the ground, the Syrian Revolution's General Commission said security forces in the army killed 25 civilians in different areas. Most died in the countryside of Damascus. The commission also reported that army forces carried out a mass arrest campaign targeting many Deir ez-Zor residents. The southern province of Daraa was subjected to raids by army tanks. The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights said three regime soldiers were killed in al-Rastan this morning.
The Syrian Observatory for Human Rights said three Syrian soldiers were killed in a failed attempt to storm the city of al-Rastan that has been besieged for days. As for Hama, the observatory said one civilian was killed by sniper fire. Activists said violent clashes erupted between a defected group and army forces. Many were killed across different Syrian cities amid solidarity protests and demonstrations. And for the ninth day, some homes' neighborhoods were shelled by the regime's army, especially in Baba Amir, that has recently received reinforcement in anticipation of escalating the military operation in the city.
There are armored vehicles and T-72 and T-52 tanks. This means Homs is being shelled, and there are reports that additional rockets were sent to Homs.
The continuous bombardment of Homs led to the killing of hundreds, injury of even more, and destruction. Activists say a humanitarian crisis is growing in some besieged areas, a crisis in food, medical supplies, communications, and fuel. The opposition is boycotting Russian and Chinese products to protest the two countries' position on the crisis. This, as Damascus is denying there's a humanitarian crisis in the country.
There is no humanitarian crisis. Hospitals are functioning normally. Medication is available. Food is available as well. But these allegations and intimidations are being exploited to push foreign intervention onto Syria.
This comes after the Arab League decided to head to the Security Council once again and ask the Council to approve a joint United Nations Arab peacekeeping force in Syria. Damascus was quick to reject the proposal.
Elsewhere in the news now, the U.S.-led NATO force in Afghanistan has admitted that several children were killed during a bombing last week. That strike happened in the northeastern province of Kapisa, where French troops are based. At the time, local officials said French commanders claimed that the target was a group of Taliban facilitators. The area was checked later and there were no Taliban. Now, NATO has admitted that, quote, young Afghans of varying ages were killed, but it seems it's shifting the blame on others. NATO says a group of armed men were engaged by a coalition aircraft. An Afghan investigation is probing the latest civilian deaths upon an order by President Hamid Karzai, who's condemned the attack. Now, in Pakistan, hundreds of angry tribesmen have marched in the northwestern city of Banu, protesting against U.S. drone attacks in the region.
These are the innocent tribesmen who defeated the British. Today, America is terrified of their might. There is no terrorist here. They're just poor tribals. This is just American terrorism. America is the biggest terrorist.
The protesters chanted anti-American slogans and assembled in a large field to listen to local leaders denounce the U.S. controversial attacks. Over the last 3 years, drone strikes have quietly become the U.S. administration's weapon of choice against militants. Since taking office, President Barack Obama turned drone attacks to a twice-weekly onslaught that claimed more than 1,000 lives in Pakistan in 2010. Washington claims the drones are used against local militants, but most often civilians are targeted.
Recent media reports said the Ministry of Women's Affairs is imposing a dress code on female employees that infringes on their personal freedoms and religious beliefs, but the minister strongly denied the claim.
The ministry said the recommendation by the Higher National Committee for the Advancement of Iraqi Women stresses the importance of female employees adhering to wearing appropriate clothing to work in government institutions.
The Ministry of Women's Affairs issued a set of guidelines suggesting that female employees should wear appropriate clothing to work in government institutions. The decision has been interpreted differently by the relevant ministries and organizations. This led activists to organize a women's rally in Al-Mutanabi Street to demand constitutional compliance. They said women's rights are equal to those of men, and that singling out women in their workplaces and undermining their reputation is an act that infringes on their honor.
No one has the right to decide what others should wear. This decision is guardianship over women and undermines women's citizenship. This is wrong.
For her part, the Minister of Women's Affairs said the decision was recommended by the Higher National Committee for the Advancement of Iraqi Women, which is subordinate to the ministry and consists of 37 members representing various ministries and government institutions. She said the decision gives women the freedom to wear what they see as appropriate, provided they respect public decency.
The dress code stipulates that female employees should wear appropriate clothes to work in the government. I believe that such a dress code gives women the freedom to wear the clothes they choose, but those that are also appropriate for the government institution they work in.
Another point that activists brought forward against the Minister of Women's Affairs, which is the subject of controversy and debate, is that the minister does not acknowledge equality between men and women, but advocates men's guardianship over women.
When she said she does not believe in equality between men and women, she broke her oath because she violated Article 14 of the Constitution, which stipulates that all Iraqis are equal before the law.
The Minister of Women's Affairs denies she advocates men's guardianship over women. She confirmed that certain statements about her private family life were not correctly interpreted.
Media outlets said I don't leave my home or go to work or to a parliamentary meeting unless my husband allows me to, and that is completely false.
Issuing a dress code that forces female employees to wear formal clothing rendered the ministry a center of protests by women activists. They view the guideline as an encroachment on women's freedom, while their minister affirms it was issued for their benefit, not to limit their freedoms. From Baghdad, Taadi Ghazala, Al Iraqiya.
Prime Minister Netanyahu today has harshly criticized Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas, accusing him of turning his back on peace after signing a reconciliation bill with Hamas. Here with the latest diplomatic developments is IBA's Ellie Wagalander. Good evening, Ellie.
Good evening and thank you, Yochanan. Prime Minister Netanyahu's comments followed those of PA President Abbas earlier in the day when he spoke to representatives of the Arab League in Cairo. Abbas told the gathering that if Netanyahu refuses to comply with his ultimatum and begin negotiations immediately, then Abbas will return to the UN in an attempt to seek a recognition of a Palestinian state. Abbas conditioned the resumption of direct negotiations on a full cessation of settlement construction, Israeli acceptance of the two-state solution on the basis of the pre-1967 lines, and the release of Palestinian prisoners and detainees, especially those who were imprisoned before the signing of the Oslo Accords in 1993. Abbas again hinted at the possibility of dissolving the PA if no progress is achieved to revive the peace process. He said he is sending a letter to Netanyahu with his demands for resuming negotiations and would wait for a response from Israel before moving on to the UN. Abbas did not have long to wait. The Prime Minister's office responded to Abbas's speech a few hours later, issuing a statement saying that the Palestinian leader has turned his back on peace Instead of entering into negotiations that will lead to an end to the conflict, Abu Mazen prefers to join up with the Hamas terrorist organization, the same Hamas that is hugging Iran. One Israeli diplomatic source, referring to the low-level Israeli-Palestinian talks held last month in Jordan, said, "Every time we start to make progress, Abbas runs away." This also characterized him during previous rounds of negotiations. Precisely when Israel starts to show flexibility is when he decides to blow up the negotiations. Meanwhile, a rare public rift broke out yesterday in the usually tightly disciplined Hamas movement. At issue is the reconciliation deal with Abbas, which would require Hamas to relinquish key areas of control in the Gaza Strip. Senior Hamas figures in Gaza, who stand to lose the most from the deal, said it was unacceptable, while top Hamas loyalists in the West Bank defended the agreement. The argument raised new questions about the ability of the two Palestinian factions to implement the deal.
More saber rattling in the Persian Gulf. Iran is reportedly building up its naval forces in the Strait of Hormuz and has now prepared small boats for suicide attacks. This as diplomatic efforts against Tehran have so far failed to deter the hardline Islamic regime. IBA's Ariel Reshef has more.
A Chinese delegation landed in Iran today in an attempt to defuse tensions over that country's disputed nuclear program. During the meeting, the Chinese envoys urged the Islamic Republic to cooperate on the nuclear issue. But China has stood behind its longtime ally in the face of growing international pressure. Despite Western efforts to isolate Iran, in recent days, the hardline regime has boasted that it will soon reveal new progress on the nuclear front and has continued its naval buildup in the Strait of Hormuz.
Some of the small boats have been outfitted with a large warhead that could be used as a suicide explosive device. The Iranians have a large mine inventory, and mines represent an indiscriminate and a very difficult maritime problem to deal with just because it's the equivalent of the IED at sea.
The U.S. Navy is making it clear that it is prepared to counter any Iranian aggression.
We spend a lot of time thinking about this, and we're very vigilant, and we've built a wide range of potential options to give the president, and we're ready.
At the same time, the U.S. is persisting in its efforts to find a diplomatic solution to the crisis.
You hear all of this discussion about, well, you know, what should we do about all of this overheated rhetoric from Iran. We really do believe that the best way to handle this is with diplomacy.
Washington continues to up the pressure on Jerusalem not to engage in unilateral actions against Iran. In a report published in today's Newsweek magazine, a senior American source is quoted as saying, the White House does not want Israel to start a war with Iran, at least not yet. But what if Israel decides to go ahead despite U.S. opposition? Newsweek claims that for months, Israel has been withholding significant information regarding its military preparations for a possible strike. And the chilly relations between President Barack Obama and Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu have done little to reassure the Israeli security establishment that the two countries are on the same page.
What I expect to hear is an announcement, a statement, given by the President of the United States, who leads the normal world and the normal superpowers, a statement that says loud and clear, Iran will not be able to complete the nuclear weapon program.
Still, some Israeli officials insist, at least publicly, that the U.S. should take the lead on any use of force.
Israel is a state, is a country. We are not a superpower. We cannot lead the world offensive against Iran.
As tensions with Iran seem to be reaching a crescendo, it remains unclear if Israel will continue to hold back. Ariel Reshef, IBA News.
In Egypt, the fact-finding committee announced the result of its investigation into the Port Said incidents, which killed more than 70 fans following a soccer match. The committee held fans and security officers equally responsible. However, the parliamentary committee's findings ruled out the incidents were part of a plot hatched by elements within the security institution, seeking to create chaos in the country. Member of the People's Assembly and head of the Parliamentary Committee, Ashraf Thabit, said in a preliminary report that incitement by sports TV channels was one of the causes of the disaster.
In an effort to revive the Arab Maghreb Union, Tunisian President Monsef Marzouki arrived in Algeria on his three-leg tour that includes Morocco and Mauritania.
Marzouki held talks with Algerian President Abdelaziz Bouteflika in the capital, Algiers. The Tunisian president expressed hope that 2012 will be a year to unify the Arab Maghreb. He confirmed he agrees with leaders of the Arab Maghreb to hold a summit this year, most likely hosted by Tunisia, amid hopes it will lead to tangible results. In Islamabad, the Pakistani Supreme Court officially indicted Prime Minister Yusuf Raza Gilani on contempt charges over his refusal to open old corruption cases against President Asif Ali Zardani.
If convicted, Gilani, who pleaded not guilty, will be forced to step down and could face up to 6 months in jail, which may push the country into a new cycle of political turmoil. Our correspondent, Mayub Khuder, reports from Islamabad.
With full confidence, he greeted his supporters before taking on the judiciary. Behind these doors and far from media cameras, a two-page list of charges was read against Pakistani Prime Minister Yusuf Raza Gilani. The charges include contempt and failure to enforce the court's decision on the expiration of the National Reconciliation Ordinance issued 2 years ago. With Gilani maintaining his innocence, the court was adjourned for 2 weeks.
The ruling People's Party is committed to abiding to the law and the spirit of democracy. I want to assure the Pakistani people that the Prime Minister did not violate the law and that he will defend himself and prove his innocence. By personally appearing at the court, the Prime Minister showed us he respects the judiciary.
By rejecting the list of charges, Gilani and his government showed they are clinging to their position by continuing to refuse to reopen corruption cases against President Asif Ali Zardari in Switzerland. Meanwhile, the Supreme Court vowed to continue fighting against corruption and punishing the corrupt. This may open a new chapter of confrontation between the government and the judiciary, with Gilani instead of Zardari being the scapegoat.
Prime Minister has lost a little.
From an ethical standpoint, the Prime Minister lost the battle inside and outside the country. His political future will be determined at the end of the trial by the Supreme Court's decision. He may be acquitted or imprisoned. But regardless, Gilani's indictment on contempt charges will shatter the coalition government and render him incompetent to serve as Prime Minister.
The political situation in the country is subject to further deterioration, especially considering that Gilani is the first prime minister to be indicted on contempt charges in the history of Pakistan. Between enforcing the law and bidding loyalty to the president, Gilani is faced with a difficult test that could cost him his position if convicted on these charges that are viewed as an insult to Gilani and to Pakistan as well. Mayub Khuder, Dubai TV, Islamabad.
Algeria's new political party held its founding congress in preparation for legislative elections scheduled for May 10th. The Justice and Development Front, led by prominent Islamist Abdallah Jabala, who recently returned to the political scene, held a public conference with the participation of thousands of the front supporters in the capital, Algiers.
The conference held by the Justice and Development Front was a political festival and rally for the newly formed political party led by Mr. Abdallah Jabala. Mr. Jabala, who is familiar with the rules of Algeria's political games, is a prominent Islamist politician who has been widely popular in the past several years.
We are working to become the top party, God willing.
Political observers viewed the large number of participants in the party's founding Congress as a political message to other political parties and the front's allies that it will have a say in the upcoming elections.
We came in second place in the 2002 elections, the last elections we took part in. Now we're in front of a new situation. We're facing a new wave of parties comprised of all social groups in Algeria. So we consider ourselves the top party in the country, God willing. As long as the people's will is respected and the elections are free, fair and democratic,
as stated in the most recent speeches by Algerian officials.
Abdullah Jabala, 56 years old, was an activist in the Islamic movement during the secret phase, which was also known as the one-party rule. He was repeatedly imprisoned in the 1980s. After the political arena allowed for a multi-party system, Jabala founded the Islamic Renaissance Party, Al-Nahda, which was succeeded later by the Movement for National Reform that won the second place in the 2002 elections. Abdullah Jabala's political ambitions are not limited to leading the new political party. He aspires to build a larger popular base, to overcome the defections that occurred during his chairmanship of former movements, and he seeks to play a more prominent role in Algeria's political life. With the establishment of the Justice and Development Front, it is safe to say the political map of Algeria will witness major changes in the upcoming elections. According to political observers, these changes will occur either within the political parties and movements or in terms of these parties' positions in elected committees. Tawfiq Karim, Al Alam, from the Algerian capital, Algiers.
The views expressed on Mosaic are from contributing broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible by grants from the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation, the Wincote Foundation, the Firedoll Foundation, and by support of viewers like you. Thank you. Watch Mosaic World News online. Stay up to date with breaking news, read our blog, get transcripts of past shows, and more at linktv.org/mosaic. Channel of uncompromising stories, world news, documentaries, entertainment, and culture. Link TV, connecting you to the world. For more information, visit linktv.org.